Hi, welcome to Myles From Home on YouTube Live. That is right. We are live. I'm David Myles, coming to you from my music room here in Fredericton, New Brunswick. Great to have you with me. Thanks so much for being here. And a special thank you tonight to Shivering Songs, an amazing festival that we're lucky to have in Fredericton. I just want to start by saying not only thank you to Shivering Songs, but a special thank you to their resilience. We talk a lot about resilience these days, getting through hard times, how important it is, you know, and how difficult it is at times. And festivals are required to be so resilient these days, as you can imagine, booking shows, canceling shows, over and over, trying to figure things out. And they had big plans for this year, and they still do. But of course, they're not able to present them right now. But they're postponing some shows, they're doing some stuff a little later on. So stay tuned to Shivering Songs. It's a really important festival run by great people here in Fredericton. And every year since 2010, they have been bringing music and art into Fredericton in the coldest month of the year, bringing light into the dark months, and they continue to do it. This year, 2022, by doing things like this. We were going to do this in person, but no, we're not doing it. It's almost like doing it in person. We're doing it like this, but we're still connecting. We're finding ways to connect. And that's, to me, that's what this is all about. So thank you, Shivering Songs, for your resilience. May we have many, many more years of Shivering Songs festivals here in Fredericton, because we're lucky to have you. Thank you so much for your support of Myles From Home tonight, because I'm excited, because I'm talking to Julie Doiron tonight. And I love Julie. I've been a fan for a long time. I've known her for a long time, and she's been making music for a long time. Now, talk about resilience. Resilience. 1990. She joined Eric's Trip. This is her fourth decade of indie rock, my friends. You want to talk about resilience, you want to talk about keeping it real, that is seriously keeping it real for into her fourth decade of making music. Now, I want to tell you something. Making music, I think a career in any country is incredibly difficult. And I kind of see it as like a pyramid. And it's not like the biggest artists are at the top. No, no, no. It's decade by decade. The first 10 years, the first decade, there's quite a few artists at that level, right? You go up to the second decade, goes a little smaller. Fewer people. Third decade, very few people have a three-decade career. Fourth decade, hardly any. Hardly anybody is in that sphere. In that spot where they've had making great records into a fourth decade. Julie Doiron is one of those people, and we're so lucky to have her in Canada and to be making music from right here in New Brunswick. That's right. She lives in Memram Cook, and that's where I'm going to be calling her in just a couple minutes on Skype, and we're going to have a chat, because that's what we do on this show. We chat about life and making music. And I want to thank all of you for being here. It's live. So if you want to leave a comment, let me know where you're watching from. Please do. Please do. I hope it all sounds good. Hope you can all hear me and see me. I appreciate you being here with me. And I'm looking forward to this chat. So Julie's just put out a new record. I Thought of You. It's one of the best records of her career, if not the best record of her career. CBC Music just listed as one of the best records of the year. It's really, really cool. So check out that record and enjoy this conversation that we're about to have with Julie Doiron. So if you have a question, you can throw it in the comments. I probably won't see it, because once we start chatting, I'm focused. But I'll do my best. You can always let me know where you're writing from and what you want us to be talking about. Thanks so much for being here. Let me try to call Julie here.
Hello, can you see me?
I can't see you yet, but I think
now can you see me?
There you go. Yeah. There you go. It's perfect.
I just got to make sure. Okay. Everything's good in there. I just was a little late on bedtime.
I hear that. Yeah, I actually just heard my kids running around upstairs. They're totally in the same boat. They're like right up here.
Oh, yeah. Elsie's just like, I just went in and she was getting out of the bed to give Milka a kiss. So he's in his little bed. And so now she's reading to herself tonight. So big girl, She used to do it all the time before, but then we got into a habit, a routine.
Yeah.
Of me reading to her again, even though she was reading to her. Well, I always read to her before, but then she was in a habit where I would read her two stories and then she would just read to herself a bit and then fall asleep. But now we're back in just like reading and then she just turns off the light and we go to sleep.
That's pretty amazing. How many kids do you have?
I have four. But the only one I still read to.
Okay.
Yeah, the other ones are all adults. So.
That's what I thought.
Yeah.
I've met two, maybe three now, but.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
You might meet one in a few minutes when she gets home from work. So.
Wow. So you've got kids at work that are old enough to have jobs. I can't wait.
I mean, they're all like, Elsie's the only one who's doesn't get paid to work yet.
Yeah.
Okay, is this okay?
It looks great. Yeah, we got people watching. This is great. Everybody says it sounds and looks good. Thanks for doing this, Julie. This is really cool.
Thank you.
You know, I was just saying in the intro, we talk about like resilience a lot right now, you know, with COVID and everything else and in the pandemic and just kind of being able to get through hard times. And, you know, I was reading your bio and I was like, you've been doing, did you realize that this is your fourth decade?
God. You know what? Sorry, David. My daughter is calling me.
No.
What do I do? She's on her way home from work.
Oh, and she needs to talk to you.
Oh, she's calling me. What do we do? Can you talk for 2 minutes and I got to take this?
Yeah, I will. I can improvise. This is how I do it. Let's.
Okay, what do I do? Do I put you on hold? Oh, wait. Oh, shoot.
Did you miss her? Okay, wait. I'll hang up and I'll call you back.
Oh, my gosh, because I just got to make sure it's not an emergency.
Of course. Of course you do. Let me hang up and I'll call you back in a second.
Okay, can you chat with the people?
I can chat with the people. Look, this is what we do.
Oh, my gosh. I'm so sorry. Okay. I'm going to call her back.
Okay, sounds good.
Are you still there? Or did I just not disconnect you?
I thought I disconnected you too, but there we go. Okay. Oh, wait, here we go. I'm disconnecting you. You're done. Oh, there we go. Look at this. This is a first. This is a first. But this is what it means right now to be a musician in the pandemic and a parent. It's how it goes. So now we're just going to take a little second, let her catch up with her daughter. And then maybe I think I actually need to call her back. So I'll just give her a couple minutes and then I'll give her a call back. And how's everybody doing? I hope you're feeling good. I hope you're feeling resilient. This is certainly not an easy time. No doubt. I've been optimistic and feeling good through most of this. And I will admit this month has been hard. But I'm feeling good. I'm feeling optimistic again. It's nice to connect, so I appreciate you being here. But let me know where you're watching from, for sure, before we reconnect with Julie here. That is a first. But, you know, she's busy. Right on. Look at this. Someone writing from Millpond. I'm going to just share that comment up here. I hope, hopefully we'll be able to get back to Millpond. Millpond's in California. It's an amazing festival. Really, really cool. Right in the desert. It's like in the desert. It's such a cool spot. Very warm for us Canadians, but we do love playing there. Thanks. Thanks for tuning in tonight. Great. Hi from Yarmouth, Nova Scotia. Oh, there she is. So that's Julie. Now, I don't think I can, maybe I can. Let me just see if I can actually take this. Thanks, Joe. Appreciate that. Let me see.
Hi.
Hey, now, I don't know if this is going to work or not. Let me just see, because I might need... Oh, yeah. No, I think it is. Now, you're there. So I'm just going to assume that everybody can see you. I think sometimes I worry that, you know, that I have to call you, but I think we're good.
Oh my gosh, your lighting and your studio situation looks so good. And I'm just like,
it looks perfect, actually. It looks really, really nice. I love the woodwork on the stairs and the plants. And it's just beautiful. So everything's okay. Everything's okay with your daughter?
Yeah, she was buying a stud finder and wanted to know if we had a level at home. So.
Oh, those are the kind of questions you want to get from your kids, though. That's the best.
Yeah, she wants to hang up she's going to install like a shelf. So she's good. All is well. She's
amazing. You know, it's funny. I've just been asking where everybody's watching from. Well, I was just kind of, filling the time. And it's amazing. There's people from Madison, Wisconsin, Grafton, Wisconsin, Dallas, Texas.
Wow.
Really, really. Huntington Beach, California.
Holy crow.
Yeah, there we go. So this is...
Hi, everyone. Thanks for watching.
Yeah, it's really cool. I mean, and I was just saying, I was talking about resilience and long careers and how hard they are in the music business. They just don't happen that much. Like, I kind of look at it as like a triangle, and at the beginning, there's quite a few musicians when you start out, when you're young, and there's like... And then it kind of gets like... fewer and fewer, and I just couldn't believe it. Like, Eric's trip, 1990, this is your fourth decade making music, Julie. Like, that's awesome. That is so impressive. What do you credit that to? Like, what is it that keeps you motivated, keeps you inspired?
Oh my gosh, I don't know. I think I just keep doing it. Like, I think, you know, for there was like a period of time in the 2000s, like around 2004 to 2008, or no, like 2003 to 2006, where I was feeling tired of like trying to kind of I thought, like, quote unquote, make it in the music industry. Like, I thought I could do that. Like, I had this little period of time where I thought, like, I'm going to try and make it. Like, I thought maybe I'll, like, I briefly considered trying to make like a commercial sounding song, briefly. Like, I didn't do it because I don't really know how anyway, but I had briefly considered doing that. And then I was like, oh no, but that's not really me. Like, I just kept making the same kind of music that I would normally make, like kind of understated, underproduced, because I don't know why I always did that, but anyway. But there was this little period where I thought, like, I really wanted to quit trying. Like, I thought I wanted to make it, and I was going to try. And then I was like, definitely didn't think I wanted to do that anymore. I wanted to stay home with my kids, and I didn't want to be like trying to be chasing after this thing that wasn't who I was anyway. And so I realized that that's not what I wanted. And then I kept making music anyway, like writing songs, even though I had tried to quit. Like, I really wanted to stay home, and then I ended up writing like all the songs for Woke Myself Up. So it just kind of kept happening. So I think the reason why it keeps happening is, like, I don't think I have any choice. Like, I think it just keeps, like, I think I just accidentally keep writing songs.
Yeah.
Like, I don't think I don't even, like, there was this long span between like this newest record that just came out and the last like solo album. And I think it was partly because I wasn't searching to do anything. I wasn't trying to be super prolific or anything. Just time went by, and I kind of didn't forget about the idea of going in the studio. But I also wasn't like desperate to get into the studio. And so, yeah, I think I just keep doing it because I like doing it, and the songs come when they come, and I don't really try to force anything. But if there is a deadline and someone proposes a project or something, I can actually do it.
Yeah.
I think I just keep doing it because, like, it's not that I don't know what else to do. I think I genuinely love songwriting. Like, right. I actually think that's what I like doing.
That's the thing. That's the main thing. Yeah. The performance is one thing. Albums are another thing. But the songs, the actual creation of the songs is the main.
So I think what ends up happening, I'm just starting to notice this recently, like, I'm starting to really understand what I want or what makes me feel good. And I have this habit of getting frustrated because I don't really have a lot of time to practice. Like, I never have time to pick up my guitar. And it's always like at the end of the day, if I'm lucky, I've played guitar maybe. And so usually it's like once a month it's ridiculous, especially you would think I'd have all this time right now to practice guitar. Like, And I don't know why it always ends up being the last thing that I do. And every once in a while, I'm like, okay, I'll do it first thing in the morning. I'll have my coffee and I'll play guitar, even if it's 5 minutes. And still, then I end up, I don't know, I end up doing other stuff, or I'm getting breakfast for Elsie if she's with me, or, and then like the next thing you know, or like then all of a sudden it's like, well, then my dog is just looking at me. So then I go walk him, and then it's like, well, I'll practice after, but then I like really want to exercise. So then it's like, am I going to exercise or am I going to practice guitar? And then usually often I don't do either. And like at the end of the day, I'm like, what did I do? Well, I usually do the laundry every morning. So that's done. But like, I do all this stuff like laundry and dishes. And then by the end of the day, it's like maybe. So I guess what I was going to say was I just started realizing recently that I really love writing songs. And when I sit down to practice, when I say, okay, finally, I'm going to sit down and play guitar, I play for like 3 minutes. I try to do some scales. I play like random chords that I'm not used to playing in together. And then like all of a sudden I write a song. So like, yeah, like right. The songs just come like in spite of like, I don't not needing them or wanting them. They just come up, which is not, I'm not complaining. It sounds like I'm complaining. But they always take over like when I'm trying to practice. So then I just end up writing.
Yeah.
Like almost like I get bored practicing and then I start writing or something. But so that's good. I'm not, that sounds like a complaint, but.
Well, it's like the relationship with the instrument is as a writing tool too. Like I think
that's what it is.
It's just like it comes from, it's not like, it's less inspiring. Did you play that much before you started writing?
No.
Yeah, right. That's that. So it's always been tied to creation and writing.
Yeah, like I think like I took guitar lessons like from the age of 15 to 17, and for one of the, so that's like 2 years, but one of those years was just a full year of classical guitar.
Oh, cool.
Which I really loved. And so during that time from the age of 15 to 17, I would say maybe I wrote like 2 songs, and they were very basic, like songs like about whatever. I mean, the same idea, like crushes or whatever, only like crushes on people who didn't know I existed, the people I would see while I was walking to school or whatever. But yeah, I would say for the most part, it became a writing tool. And especially like after Eric's trip, because like I was using more like just really loose like power chords just to guide the song along for sure. And then when I started working with the Wooden Stars, I really kind of inspired me to maybe practice the guitar a little more and learn how to play better, because they were such strong and amazing musicians that like, maybe I should at least learn. So that's when I started coming up with more creative guitar parts for sure. Like that was what, because I was already used to doing classical guitar. So I already knew how to finger pick and do like, you know, things that were maybe not necessarily like, I don't know, like the foundations of like, maybe like, I wasn't like a folk writer or whatever. Like I was used to classical guitar and I was used to like trying different things.
Yeah. Yeah. And different parts of the neck and stuff too. Right.
Exactly. Like I wasn't always in first position. And then I, with the Wooden Stars, that really kind of opened up my eyes and world, where I was like, okay, maybe I don't need to just do power chords to write songs. And that's when I started exploring more other parts of the neck and trying to be fancy. But I still wasn't doing what they were doing, but I was like definitely trying to like open up my guitar playing.
It's good though. I mean, that's the nice thing about working with other people, is that they kind of like open up new lanes of thinking about music. And they were, you know, they're a great band, amazing players.
But yeah, and for me, it felt like I was playing these really hard guitar parts, but they were probably super, they're not that hard. It's just like, I was like, okay, this is unusual for me, but it was good.
No, yeah. It's interesting. You know, you touched on a whole whack of things that I want to talk about, but one thing I want to go back to is this idea of like, you know, I often talk to musicians about when they want to quit, like how many times have they wanted to quit? And it's crazy how many times correspond to when they've gone for it, when they've like, okay, I'm going to take this time. I'm going to do this. The thing I've now identified what success looks like in the music industry, not according to ourselves. I'm going to pursue it. And then when it doesn't work, because that's not how it works. That's not how it works anyways. It's like kind of devastating. But it's also like liberating, or if you don't go through it, you don't have a two, a three decade, four decade career. Like it is impossible because you will give up, right? Like, it's also what opens up that possibility of going, no, I get to define my career for what I want to do now. But mm-hmm. like for so many people, it requires like first making that attempt, mm-hmm. it not necessarily working as it might, or realizing that it's just not what you're actually, what you want at all. And then mm-hmm. having that redefinition of what you want your career to look like. And then it's quite liberating.
It's super liberating. Yeah. Yeah. I think when the minute, or once you realize like you, that, well, I think it became liberating for me when I realized like I could just do whatever music I wanted to do. And that, and I think what was even also part of that, what was liberating as well, was realizing that I like could get by on just having like 100 people at a show or 50 people at, you know what I mean? Like I didn't have to be selling out venues to be able to do music. I wasn't always living comfortably, or not comfortably is the wrong word. I wasn't always paying all my bills on time, but like, but I think realizing like, oh, depending on like, there is something to be said for having like a regular paycheck and that, like, just to take the edge off and to know that you don't have that stress all the time. But I think that also when you realize like, when you're like, well, what do I want or what do I need? Like, well, I need to be able to feed my children and I need to be able to pay the rent and pay, like, you know, heat the house and things like that. So I think you don't need to have a number one single over and over and over to be able to do those things. You just need to make the music you want to make. And then I think that when you make the music you want to make, then you end up like having fans or people who like what you do, who like everybody who likes what I do has been super loyal, and they followed me through the this journey, I guess, of like making music for 4 decades. But like, and so I think that because I always made the music I wanted to make and really listened to my heart and that, like, doing the music that I want to make, I think that made it so that I have, like, a really loyal fan base, like, or people who like what I do. And so those people, when they know there's a show, they come to the shows.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, that's another thing of, like, having good promotion and having people who actually promote the shows. That helps a lot, too. But, I think the liberating thing was realizing, like, I didn't need to be super famous or huge or anything to be able to keep doing music as a career. Obviously, it's wonderful when you get a really great, like, when if you happen to have, like, a song that gets placed or whatever, that's, like, really nice to have, like, that to be able to pay bills, like, for a year without, like, having to, or 6 months or 2 months or whatever the placement is. Or and I was always hesitant, like, that idea of like letting someone use your song, obviously when I was younger, was like, that seemed so lame to like, it was, when you were young, it's like that's selling out or whatever. But when you're older and you have gone so long with not really being able to pay bills, you're like, you know what? Maybe I get to actually, I'm going to say yes to this one.
I feel like the industry changed. The attitude also changed. It wasn't just people getting older, it was also just like, I think young bands too were
records.
Kind of okay with it, like they exactly, like I remember, and I've talked to Joel about this too, you know, in the 90s it was like you don't sell songs, can't be anywhere touch a commercial entity,
like a product, yeah,
you know, and then, you know, through a career it changes, but it's not even, it's more that just every other source of revenue started to dry up for musicians.
Exactly. Yeah. Yeah. When people weren't buying records, and then like, so I think what happened was like when people stopped buying records, or when that industry kind of changed, and then so the need to buy records wasn't there, then all the people who were living off of making music suddenly had to do way more touring and way more shows. Yeah. And so all of a sudden we were all doing shows and touring, but people weren't going to like 5 shows a night every week, you know? So people were being, I think people had to choose selectively, like, okay, which artist am I going to go see this month? You can't go see like 20 shows when you know, a month, like if everyone's touring. So then it made it like a little bit tough on everyone. So yeah, if you were offered like the opportunity to have a song placed somewhere, it's like, okay, well, this could actually really help.
Yeah. I feel like everybody kind of understood. They were like, yeah, good for them.
Yeah. I hope so. You know, anyway. I mean, like, obviously there's still products I would definitely say no to, but there's like, if it happened, but anyway, I don't know why I went on that tangent. Maybe I'm just thinking about money right now because like still everything is canceled and there's like, there's no more CRB or no more benefits or anything. So you're like, oh,
Well, this is it. It's just like, this is, it's like going back to that concept of like resilience. This is like nonstop. Mm-hmm. It's just like, you know, I was talking about Shivering Songs, like these festivals, promoters, agents, you know, like I have everybody's booking shows and canceling shows, and then they're working just to not make any money come in. Like it is a very, very tricky time. And, and if anything, I think in some ways, the musical community were quite used to a bit of like scarcity and uncertainty. Uncertainty is kind of like in most musicians' DNA. We're kind of familiar with it, and even now we're like, "Holy, this is a lot of this is like ongoing uncertainty for a long time, and it's hard."
Yeah, and in the past, when things have been uncertain, in that since we're talking finances all of a sudden, which I don't usually do that often.
It's a podcast about financing. No, I'm just.
But I think like in the past when I've been in situations like under normal conditions when you can just like go touring or book like a last minute show somewhere or whatever, like that used to really drive me. Like when I had no money, like, and I was, when I, the points where I would be like, okay, how am I going to make it through this month? Well, I'd be like, well, who do I know who can just book me this weekend? Like, so then I would like contact people, maybe book a show in 2 weeks. And then just, I was used to like kind of making it work, and it would push me to work really hard. Like, or like, and so, I mean, I'm getting older now, so like that drive, like even a while ago, like I just got, like, I boiled water all day to fill the bathtub, so that, because I just, we're like our oil tank, like I'm still on an oil tank, and anyway, I don't, it's been cold, and I just, whatever, I'm not going to go into details, but I didn't want to use any of the water for, because the hot water heater's oil.
Oh, and yeah,
so
right.
So it took like all day, like I used this big pot, and so Elsie and I just shared the bath water, and then like we got, I was like, he's calling you a few minutes, like I just got out of the water, and I was like,
oh my goodness.
But, like, just like, and you know what, whatever, it sounds like, I'm not, like, I'm good, everything's, like, we're good, we've got, like, I have this habit of, like, making sure there's always a lot of food, like, cans of food and stuff for those, and plus we live in the country, so I don't live next to a grocery store, so I'm used to having, like, stuff, but I guess I want to stop talking about that because I feel weird all of a sudden talking about finances.
Yeah, no, but I don't know how we actually even got on here.
I don't know how
here.
I got there. But it's on my mind because I think it's just on my mind.
But
because,
I'm glad. I mean, honestly, it's an honest conversation, so I'm glad we're talking about it. It's just how it goes because this is it does speak to the overall nature of the conversation, which is that music careers are difficult and they don't necessarily get easier.
Right. They and don't the thing necessarily with the musical career easier. Is that your money, you don't have a regular paycheck. And that's I think what we were getting. Like, so in the past, like sometimes we're like, when, especially when my kids were young, like we, and when I was married with John, like he's a painter and an artist. So like often it was like, we'd call our parents. And back then there was no e-transfers. So it was like, I don't even know how they sent us money. I know that there was a few times where we had to ask for money when we were living out of town. Anyway, there was a few times where I was like, when we were really broke, I went and busked, you know, downtown Montreal. And then like, you know, you'd busk for a few days and all of a sudden like the SoCan check would arrive.
Yeah,
and you'd be like, woohoo,
yeah,
I'm gonna go busking today. But it's like, but there's no stability. And so that's the thing, you get used to. It does add an element of stress. For sure, that I'm not sure is necessary to be happy in the world. But like, I think that it also makes you really appreciate like when you do get like, then that's why I think like I've always had, I'm terrible with money. Like when I get a little bit of money and it's like, oh, maybe let's go have dinner. Let's go eat
right.
a restaurant.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, then all of a sudden it's all gone again. It's like, oh, okay. But yeah. So
but
I
mean,
think that with a musician, like I think that we've always really appreciate when people come to the shows. And especially during the pandemic, like I was able to do 3 shows. Well, I did a few more, but just in December, I did 3. I was right in that moment where the cases were low just before they took off again. Just in, for those watching in the States, like in Canada, we're, I don't really know what's going on in all the, I think all the provinces are kind of going through the same thing right now with the hospitals and stuff. But all that to say that I did those 3 shows and people were super grateful to be out at a show, and people like were buying the record and buying t-shirts, and it was really, really nice because that was just really helpful.
Yeah, it is, and it's a feeling that you can kind of feel like you're in the dark a lot this year. You know what I mean? Like mm-hmm. where you've had that career. You talked about that, like when you start doing your own thing. And you've always done your own thing, but even that whole thing of redefining your career, being liberated to do your own thing, you realize that your fans that then are interested in you, and as you said, they're loyal to you. They love you because of you. They know you because you're now you're doing your thing. They know you. You have this relationship, and it's an ongoing. When you're touring a lot, you see them, and you're kind of reminded that you have a relationship with these people, and you're mm-hmm. making art that is affecting people. And during this time, it's really difficult to sometimes we can lose sense of that. So even those little, I did a few shows, and it was the same thing. I was like, I don't miss playing live, and then I did it, and I was like, wait a minute. I absolutely do. Like,
yeah.
In fact, I don't think I would write words if there, I don't think I would write songs in the same way if there wasn't an audience to sing them for.
Yeah. I did a show in St. John, New Brunswick last, I don't know what year. Like, well, March.
When did this start?
I did one in November for Quality Block Festival in St. John. In November 2020, I guess. Yeah, because we just made it through. Yeah, it was like a year ago. And we were in the yellow phase. And I felt so good on stage. Yeah. Like, and you know, it was like, a 900 capacity theater. And they sold like 140 tickets. So it was like a very distanced. It was like large theater. Everybody had space. It was super well done. Everybody was really respectful. There was an intermission. And, you know, just being on stage and hearing like a response and clapping. I couldn't see the people because it was a theater and the lights were running. And that's okay for me. But like just knowing they were there, like it felt good. Yeah. Like, no. And a while ago I said, like, I really love writing songs. I also love performing. I'm just not good at jamming in general. But anyway,
interesting.
I'm like so nervous about jamming, making up stuff. Like if I do.
Yeah, they do. I mean, like all of this is great. Like I like doing virtual things, but we've all talked about it since. Like conversations are one thing, but man, playing music it's just not the same. And it's not the same for the audience. It's not the same for us. And so I know it makes you realize, I mean, for me, I think it's in some ways it's been good because it made me realize I was taking for granted certain things too, you know, like some of that mm-hmm. magic of the live show. Cause you know, mm-hmm. I'd done enough of them and I was kind of like, oh, and I got young kids and I was kind of getting, you know, a little worn down and too. And I also now I've gotten back to doing these shows where I'm like, wow, what a magical career. Like what a magical weird thing that we do. It's so odd.
Yeah.
When you feel like you're doing something that is yours and you feel like they're responding to that thing, you know, that mm-hmm. you know, rather than that experience of, okay, I'm going to try to go for this or try to be someone else. And then, because it's almost like it's almost sometimes I it's almost worse if people respond to that, because how are you then going to create it again? You're doomed. It's like a terrible loop.
Yeah.
You know,
and I've been, a while ago when you mentioned like the, you know, like the relationship that we have with the people who come to the shows and how that builds, like there are people that I've known for years that like, that I see when I go on tour that, and you know, I hadn't toured, for example, like I hadn't toured in the US, like it was a long time. Like I toured there in 2019 with Mount Erie and I don't think I had toured in the US since like 2010 or 11 prior to that. So I saw a lot of people on that tour that I hadn't seen in a long time, but they still came. And it was really nice, like to be in touch with people. And you know, for years and years and years and years and years, actually, almost my whole like solo career. So not when I'm like touring with other people, but like, well, even some other, all kinds of tours. Like I usually stay at people's houses and. Not during the pandemic, the few shows that I did, but I usually end up like, because I've never been very well organized and I usually didn't have, like, I would just like do that thing from the stage and be like, oh, if anybody wants us to stay at their house tonight, like, and that's how I toured all over North America. Just like, there was even like one time in Thunder Bay, like a long time ago when it was with the Wooden Stairs, where I went up to this person after the show and I was like, I guess we'll take you up on your offer because someone else had said we could stay with them. But like, I went up to the wrong person. I was like, I guess we'll take you up on your offer. And he was like, what offer? And I was like, oh, to stay at your house. And he was like, that wasn't me, but I guess I can call my mom and ask if that's okay. And I was like, yes. And then we went and stayed at...
No, you didn't. You ended up staying with them?
At his mom's house, yeah. So that was actually like something we joked about. Like, I guess I should do that every night. Like, I guess I'll take you for you. Like, what? That wasn't me. But like, yeah, so I met a lot of people that doing that, like staying at people's houses. It was usually like, it was for a couple of reasons, partly because I was unorganized and never could plan ahead, but also I didn't have the budget to get hotel rooms. But also I really liked staying with people because I didn't really like staying in hotel rooms like that much. I felt like at the time I was just not what I wanted.
And it gives you that personal connection. Now, you know, there's like people on the ground that know you and you know them. And that really helps when you're doing that kind of touring.
Well, especially like touring places where like if you're not getting paid a lot, like because a lot of like back then when I was, especially when I was touring like the States, it was like you were playing for the door and you were sharing the door with like three other bands. And, you know, sometimes it wasn't a huge turnout. So that would be like, you know,
right.
You don't have a credit card then.
So how does it feel now like to have a new record? I mean, mm-hmm. It's got to feel really good. I mean, the reviews have been amazing. And I mean, besides the reviews, my personal review, which is essential, is that it's an amazing record. It sounds so good, Julie. It sounds like, it sounds fun. It sounds like a band that's really rocking together. There's the softers. There's these beautiful, like, what's the darkness? Darkness to
darkness
light.
There's
like some really beautiful, sensitive moments. Like, Darkness to Light is like, to me, is like, in a really important song. It feels really important for now for people going through this pandemic. It's one of the strongest songs I've heard in a long time about mental health and wellness and how that can work. There's all these lyrics about how darkness can trap you, make you feel like you belong there. I just find that it's such a powerful song. But then there's these other songs that are just the arrangements and the way the band's playing. It just feels so good. It feels like you guys are having fun.
Well, I have to like really credit. I feel like I can't say this enough. My mom was just texting me a while ago saying like she was concerned that because I was frozen in the image, but she just told me it's working now. But that might be her iPad.
Oh, yeah. It was just my little quick freeze. I love, my mom does
like,
the same
frozen,
thing.
Frozen,
I love,
isn't it like, the I best? Mom, I can't, sorry. But she just let me know that it's.
I'll get the text after. See, I turn my phone off, then I'll get the text from my mom after. That will be like, well, you look great, but your forehead was shiny.
I like to think of that more as just like, I like the translucence. That's one of the things, I can't go for that. I was just going to say, like, I've been always really, really lucky with the people I collaborate with. Like, I was making this record with friends. And so we just, like, Daniel Romano, Ian Romano, and Danny Placard. Danny Placard's my boyfriend.
Okay.
And then Daniel and Ian are longtime friends that I've known for a really long time. So it didn't take long for it to just, we set up. And then I think the first song the first song we played was You Gave Me the Key. And it just like was like maybe three takes max. Like we probably ran it once and then like play, like it was really just so relaxed and natural. And in fact, I had sent them versions of the songs, just guitar and voice, and they didn't want to listen to them. So, which I had done that in the past. When I made a record with Herman Dune, like back in 2003 or whatever, I actually wouldn't let them hear the songs before because I wanted to do this. I was like on a Bob Dylan kick where I had just read like one of the biographies or whatever. So, those guys didn't want to hear the songs. And so the songs all came out really spontaneously and really just natural. And so it's really thanks to the musicians. I think that the vibe on the record I don't feel like I can take credit for the vibe. I guess it's a combination of all four of us. And
well, you sing great on it. Your singing is great. I mean, the songs, you can take credit for that. I mean, the voice is what comes comes across. I love the arrangements. Like, I love the fact that it feels rocking, but at the same time, it's not improvised. Like, it feels like there's kind of parts, which is cool, right? Like, there's like some great guitar hooks, and you know, I love that stuff too.
Well, and that, and yeah, Daniel is really great at that kind of thing. Like, he, and when we were, there was no producer. Nobody was in the producer's role on this record. We all decided to have equal parts in that. And like, I didn't really want, I don't know, I'm really bad at making decisions, and I just don't ever want to be, I have a hard time like committing to things. So like, having everyone work as a team and having like people like suggest ideas, and then like, I prefer that just to having like one person making all the decisions. Yeah. Like, for me, this, so yeah, like, we would be tracking, and then like, so Daniel was kind of on a roll. He'd be like, oh, can I go try this thing? And he would like run off to like the Wurlitzer or the whatever, and he'd come back and be like, okay, that's great. Or like, can I try this guitar? Like, and he was on such a roll, I'd be like, yeah, do it. Because like, why not? You know, that was great. And so it just kept rolling along. It went so fast. We were done all the tracks and like all the overdubs, like in 3 days, like the tracks and the overdubs in 3 days. And
the whole record.
Yeah, and then Daniel and Ian left on the fourth morning because they were going on tour in the States like a few days later, and they wanted to go home for a couple days. And then I did the vocals on the fourth day. I started like all the vocals. There are like two or three songs on the record that we kept the bed track vocal. Okay. Like on Dreamed I was the original vocal, and on They Wanted Me to Say was the original vocal. Which was a surprise because I was really like focusing on trying to guide the vibe for that one. Like the second last song, that was just like, and I loved the vibe so much, and we kept that vocal.
Oh, that's and cool.
I think there was one other song that was the original vocal that I didn't overdo.
That is so quick. That's quick.
It was really fast, but they were very efficient.
It doesn't surprise me. I mean, friggin' Daniel Romano's made like 15 records in the last year and a half. He's the most productive person in Canada. He's a freak. He's, you know what I mean? So I love his music so much, but it doesn't surprise me that that's how that things move quickly.
Yeah. And you know what? It's really nice to be in the studio with people that you really have faith in what they do, because you don't even need to be like, oh, I don't know about that part. Like, you're like, yeah, go.
Yeah, right. Yeah. Like, and they obviously feel the same way. You know, like, it really, like, you don't work that quick if they're not second guessing the songs or your vocal performance and all that stuff, which is huge, right? It works because everybody's in it. And you've made records with Daniel before, right? You made that trio, Fred.
We did the Daniel, Fred, and Julie record. That's right. That was like in 2 days. I think it was like 1 or 2 days. And I mean, that was another project where Daniel, like, I think called, and then he was like, I'm going to take the train to Sackville and we're going to do this project. And he got there like 2 days later, and he worked on all the arrangements on the train on the way to Sackville, and we did it in Fred's garage. So yeah, like, that all came together very quick. And also, yeah, I sang on one of his solo records, like the third one, the Come Cry With Me.
Oh, yeah,
I was
great.
One of the singers in that one. But yeah.
Oh, that's it. And I've been to that studio you made that record in, Baidu's. Isn't that where you made the record? What a spot. I made a video in there one time.
Okay. Yeah. It's pretty amazing.
Incredible. Yeah. It's like this sweet mansion from the like late 60s or 70s. It's just a total trip.
Yeah. So nothing's changed. And it was really nice. It was winter. It was February. It was freezing. And so it was a good, I think that's another key, is like removing, I think for working efficiently and quickly in a studio, I think removing yourself from any distractions and just going and isolating yourself somewhere. And I think winter might be a good time for that, because then you're just going to be like, well, you don't really want to go outdoors that much if you're there to work. And so like, yeah, it kind of kept us focused. And
It's in rural Quebec, so it's not, you know, so it's easy to focus. Not much else
exactly,
going on.
Exactly. Like, I record it in cities too, so there's good points to everything.
No, that's interesting. Well, I mean, how does it feel now having it out and being in the, you know, to reconnect with these fans that are all over the place? It must be nice to be hearing from all those fans, because it's been since, when was the last time you put out a record? 20 solo record was 2012?
Well, it was 2012. Was So Many Days came out in 2012, and not a whole lot of people heard that one because it just came out like on in Canada, and it kind of disappeared shortly after. So I think it's available digitally, but it was a record that I really liked, but it didn't really get, it didn't really get heard, I don't think, by that many people. And then I was still doing lots of shows and doing this thing, like this project, the Canta en Español project that I do with Acuarela, that comes out, every time I'm touring in Spain, that's when I record more of the songs. And then we work really a lot, like on the pronunciation and stuff. And Jesus chooses the songs and does these adaptations and very poetic translations of the songs. So that's a really nice ongoing project that I've been working on. But also during that time period since 2012, I also did the Julie and the Wrong Guys thing, which...
Oh, that's right.
Which we went into a cabin for a week in Manitoba, an hour outside of, I think, Red Lake. I feel like that's where we were. An hour outside of Winnipeg, and we wrote all the songs. There was a couple that we went in with, but the guys wrote all the music, basically. There's a few things that I wrote the music for, and then I wrote the lyrics, and there was, by the end, I had never done that. I had never gone and just isolated with people and just actually written the songs together. I was actually very nervous, and when the drummer, Mike Peters, called me, he was like, we got a grant to do this record and we're going to do it. And, and I was like, I don't have any songs. And he was like, I hadn't been writing anything. I hadn't written since the 2012. I had Elsie in 2013 and I had decided not to write anymore. I wanted to take time off. I wanted to be home and I didn't know what to write about. And he was like, it's okay. Don't worry. We're just going to hang out and, eat and, make a fire. And we'll be it was October and it's going to be great. And we'll jam in the daytime. And then it was so supportive and positive. And in the morning, I would do some yoga or I'd go, there was a lake and these guys would make breakfast and then I would write lyrics and then we would jam. It was really incredible process for me because wow. I had never co-written before.
And it worked. So
yeah. I loved it. And that record is really, I think that record is super fun and it's really awesome. And I think we had a lot of fun doing those shows after. So I was keeping busy. I just wasn't making any solo music.
Right.
Yeah. So I think that reconnecting with the people that have been since this record came out. Well, actually, so just to touch on this new record, it came out. This is the first time I've put out a record like this since with all the social media existing. I think I only had an Instagram account. I started my Instagram account in 2018, and it was because John Clater, who is the father of my first two children, my ex-husband, he had just gotten his puppy Stella that summer, and she had her own Instagram account and I wanted to follow Stella, so I started an Instagram account to follow a puppy. I needed to watch her grow up, and so then I started this Instagram account just for that. That was, I think, 2018. It hasn't been a long time.
And so now, promoting a record looks completely different than it did in 2012, because now it's basically on you. Doesn't it seem like it's so
hard?
Yeah.
It takes me so many hours just to make one post, because I'm I take days to figure, what am I going to do for my post, and how am I going to, and then, I always inevitably think, oh my God, I forgot to thank that person, I'm still trying to think, there's still a few people that I need to add to the post that I just made, I didn't tag, I'm still thinking, I take it so, you have to hire someone. To do that.
I know. Well, I know. The thing is, then it doesn't work. This is what they always say, right? The whole nature of social media is that it's from you. It is you. And it can be filled with mistakes. But it's a hard thing to get used to when the old version of things was certainly a lot more it was kind of not controlled, but it was planned or something,
I know. Well, and I write every post as if it's a letter and I always have to sign off. I don't know. It's every text I ever write to someone's XOXO. See, hey, it's Julie, by the way. It's yeah. I know you're in my contacts. It's oh my gosh. I don't know. I just fell into that generation where I didn't jump in. I still don't have a computer. And it's really, when people say, hey, can you send me an invoice? I'm no, actually, no, I can't.
Right. Yeah.
It takes me 3 hours to make an invoice.
You just need one of your kids is going to just have to take over your social media account. Just get you a TikTok account run by one of your kids.
Yes. I don't want TikTok account.
No.
I think part of what happens is I get so scared. I get easily addicted to things. And I'll sometimes take my phone out to try and make just share something on a story or try to do. And I go on and I forget why I took out my phone. And next thing you know, 45 minutes later, I've like commented on people's like sent people like, you know, just reached out or whatever. And I still haven't done the post I was supposed to do.
Yeah.
And like, I didn't make a post when the record first came out. And then I'm so like, I was like, oh, well, I kept waiting for like, cause the record came out on a Friday. So I was like, well, maybe I'll make one like, you know, 4 weeks at, like, cause I didn't get to do it the first day that it came out. Cause I was like, I didn't want to miss anyone and all the credits and I needed to have to sit down and do that. It's like, then when I have the dog and then Elsie, it's like, then I can't, I don't know.
Yeah. It can just short, sweet, quick and full of mistakes. It's a weird new world where it's like more about, like a constant flow, it seems. I mean, and you, by the way, everything you're saying makes total sense to me, especially the addiction thing. Like you and everybody else, I get on the thing and I'm like, oh yeah, what's this? And then I'm like, basketball highlights, whatever, guitar solos, trumpet players. I'm like, yeah, this is great, you know, but I don't, it's a wormhole, insane wormhole.
Yeah. And I'm really trying to read books and
I've almost forgotten what they are.
Yeah.
but important. They're important. And that pace is important. Because that's actually the creative pace. Mm-hmm. That's the interesting thing, right? Is that, I mean, not that it's not, you can work quickly, like Daniel Romano works quickly, but often, like for me, and it sounds like for you, I write often in isolation. I write often by, you know, it is an isolated and slow process sometimes. It's mm-hmm. not when I'm on my phone. It's not when I'm distracted. It's not even in that speed. If I'm operating on that speed where it's like TikTok's, and I joke about that because it is, it seems like actually the word, like it's so much, it's so overloaded that I'm like, this is not good. This, my brain can't operate at this speed. I mean, I'm sure it would from an addiction perspective, but I'm sure I can't imagine it being great for me. And especially not for like the creative part, which is essentially what I'm trying to keep alive.
Yeah. And I think that we need this. So I think I finally managed to find a balance with my Instagram presence. Like I've basically forgotten that Facebook exists. Like I never make posts on, I've hit the little button on Instagram that makes it so that it shares automatically to Facebook. And then like my music Facebook, like someone else makes those posts for me based on what I put on my Julie page. And then they just share it. So, because I can't do it all, I can't.
No.
And then I don't even do my own Twitter like that. I've never had access to the Twitter account. I always forget it exists. Like I don't even know.
Right.
But what I was gonna say was like I think I finally found a balance because there was a time where I got a little bit addicted to it. I was on it, like, you know, last year. But I find like if I do, like maybe like a day or two of activity, and then sometimes I'll just go like a week or two without going near it, because otherwise I don't get any creative work done. And I find I really need those moments. I need to go back. My brain is like a constant snowstorm at the best of times. It's like thoughts just like chum, 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 chum all the time. Like, oh, I gotta do this thing. I gotta do that thing. I gotta do that. And then sometimes I'll just turn in circles around my house and be like, like, what was that? I was like, and then I pick up my phone and like, well, and then I'm like, oh, right. This. And then like, I don't. So I have to. My brain has always been a snowstorm. But now that I have no focus seemingly. And actually, last year was the first time where I actually got relaxed in a long time. Wow. Like when all my tours got canceled last year, like I was supposed to be touring like a lot last year. And when everything got canceled and I wasn't late for anywhere because I'm notoriously late. Like I don't know how to get anywhere on time. And I apologize to everyone I've ever made. Like, and it's not a control thing. It's not, I don't believe it's about manipulation. I think it's just, I have no ability to get anywhere like on time at all. Like I was talking to someone earlier and I was like, oh, you know, like when I look at the clock and it's like 10 to 3 and I'm like, oh, I'm not late yet. I don't have to be there till 3, but I know it takes me 25 minutes to get there.
Yeah.
I'm going to be late. Or maybe did I say that to you earlier? No.
No, but I've enjoyed being in Fredericton because I keep on winning. Like I keep on, like things are quite close here. So it's been a great advantage where I was used to, I pulled the same thing off. I'm like, oh, I'm sneaking. And then every once in a while here, because I moved from a bigger city to a smaller town, I've it's not going to last long, of course, because I'm going to then know the math is less favorable and, you know, mess with it. But for the first little while.
All my clocks are set, like all the clocks in my house are set 8 minutes fast.
Here you go. Well,
at first they were 5 minutes fast, and then somehow some of them are like 8 minutes. So now I don't know which ones, but they're all minimum 5 minutes at least fast.
Okay.
So now I know I always have like a 5 minute buffer, but, and that trick works for me still. I know they're fast, but this still helps me. It actually does work, but, I don't know why it's like that, but I was going to say that last year was the first time in a really long time, in spite of it. I mean, last year was horrible for so many humans, and it's been a really difficult time. And, you know, I would not want, like, I've been lucky. I'm still healthy, and I'm not, like, I haven't gone through anything that's been, you know, difficult health-wise. And so I'm really sorry for all the people who have had loss and have gone through, like, what they've been going through during this time. But in terms of my stress level of, like, everything getting canceled, and then like having the like for so if people who are not in Canada are watching this, we were really lucky here in Canada that many people, not everyone, but some of us had access to the emergency, like the CERB, the Canadian Emergency Response Benefit or whatever, and so that really helped me live a better quality of life than I had been living for quite a while.
Right.
Like that served the payment I was getting from the government, like during the pandemic, was like super helpful. And I think a lot of musicians I know, like we were all thriving. we were home, our tours were canceled, but we had access. Not everybody I know, like some people I know chose not to apply for it or whatever, but like I ended up having to pay back like the last five payments that happened in the fall because like whatever, it was I messed it up, but anyway, it really helped a lot. And so I lost all those tours and I left, but like at the same time I was like home with my family. I was relaxed. I wasn't arriving late for anywhere. Wow. I wrote a lot of songs last year and like songs that I really like. And so I think that it was like just relaxed enough that I could be creative and I wasn't like stressed and I wasn't like running around, like just spinning around and be like, I don't know what I'm supposed to do. Like I was it wasn't until this year I became more stressed. Like this year I felt a lot more stressed and I was going for I go for walks in the woods every day and I was crying every day for like 2 months in March and April. Like I just couldn't, like I would just start crying. Feeling like I was really like, what's the point? Like why, right. Like I was in that place where I was like, this is crazy. Like, why are we here? Like I was having all those, it's just like being like, oh, why? But,
well, it's so hard. There's so little direction, right? There's so little, that's what's really tough in these moments, you know, especially when that's the feeling, when that's the overall feeling, it's hard to see what a future looks like.
Yeah.
That's devastating. That's very hard.
That's because and I don't know if I'm only really feeling that more since the pandemic or if it's because I'm almost 50 or if because I used to feel that way at times before. Oh, sorry. My daughter just got home. Hey, guys. so all is well. Oh, and Milka just shook off. My dog was sleeping upstairs and everyone's good. I guess I was sorry, Mike. Is Mike Fierstack watching? Because he just texted me saying, remember when you were taking the Greyhound from Montreal and the bus driver said he pooped his pants? It's like, because I knew. And it just came. And that happened to me, poor guy.
The bus, sorry, was, can you, yeah, can you?
Like, so my text, I guess I forgot to put my phone on.
It's okay. I don't say, yeah, that's the best. I'm glad Mike's watching. I love Mike.
So, well, I don't know if he's watching or if he just remembered that story. But, yeah, I used to take the bus all the time from Montreal to Sackville when I was like back and forth between. And I don't think this will be insulting to the. Anyway, I was taking the bus and somewhere near Rivière-du-Loup, which is like one of the stopover points where they change bus drivers, the bus driver, like, everybody was sleeping. And it was a wild bus ride. Like people, they used to stop like at Perth Andover and a few other spots and like all the smokers would get out. And then like, and I remember at one point everyone got back on, but a bunch of people were standing up and didn't want to sit down because somebody had like thrown up on the floor. But So nobody wanted to sit back in their seats because the vomit was on the floor. And the bus driver like had gone to look at it, and he just was like, and then he just like walked back to his seat and started driving, and everybody was just like, and then so nobody, so I don't know what they did, but everybody sat down, and then like shortly, like around, we were all sleeping, and the bus stopped and the lights came on, and then I heard like, I kind of opened, and the bus driver stood up and he was like, there will be a brief stop here. I just, and I don't know if I can say the S-H-I-T word on this, but he's like, there'll be a brief stop here. I just shit my pants. And then he just like walked up the bus, and everybody was like, huh? And the woman was like, one woman was like, well, thanks for telling us. And the woman next to me, I was like, did he just say what I think he said? She's like, yeah, I think so. And then he got off the bus and someone got on and cleaned the seat. And
the show went
then
on.
They changed buses, and we, I think we changed buses and we went, continued to Montreal. And yeah, that was
resilience.
So Mike Fiersek, if you're watching, that was me. I will text him after that. If he's, if that was just a random remembering, but yeah, that happened. That was really like a wild bus trip. I feel like it was one other thing that had happened too, where like, it was just like building for him where he was probably just, oh, it was a snowstorm, crazy snowstorm.
Right.
So I don't know if he just, he could have been joking too. Like maybe he just was like, I quit.
Because this is too crazy. Well, I mean, it's crazy. Bus trips are crazy. It feels, it's almost, it's funny to talk about bus trips because they feel so foreign right now.
I know.
Like there's
I
a
know,
whole bunch of activities.
They're happening.
Of course, they're happening. Yeah, of course. And then, you know, people, I mean, for sure. I had imagined they're happening all the time. But there's just certain things that I haven't done in so long that they
the
literally.
Train is back running as well. Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Yep, I saw it. No, I know. I can't imagine sitting on a bus next to, like, I did it all the time. You didn't think twice. And now the idea of like sitting like less than you'd be like, they must have distancing.
I don't know how they're doing it, but yeah, no, it's, I mean, and we'll do it again. I'll get back on the Greyhound. I will someday, but they're always, they were always, I did tons of bus trips too. And they're just wild. They're just wild. But so, and how are you feeling before we take off? How are you feeling now? How are you feeling now? Yeah, I know. It's crazy. Eh? How are you feeling now? You're feeling pretty good now. And I mean, January's been a hard month. I was saying it's been a tough month for sure, just because of the state of the pandemic, and New Brunswick's been obviously pretty heavy.
I feel really good today. I had a, what day is it? Tuesday. I had a heavy day. I wasn't feeling like particularly good. It goes in waves.
Yeah.
It goes in waves. I feel good lately. Yeah, and I think I'm learning how to navigate like that. I think I'm learning. You know, it goes in waves. I don't know. But I think that everyone I know is experiencing that. And again, I don't know if it's coming with age or if it's really only because of the pandemic or like if we would. But I think I'm good. Like today was good. I'm trying not to be stressed. I'm trying to like, and I'm also trying to be really kind to myself, like on the days where like I can't get the stuff done that I want to get. And it's crazy. Like sometimes, like if there's a friend around or whatever, like the, when they see how much I have to try and do in a day, like, and I have no ability to like, I don't seem to know how to like actually tackle the tasks in a organized manner. So like when I make my to-do list, it just seems like all the things I have to do at the same time. Like, I don't know how to like, I need like a life coach. I need someone to go like, okay, do the thing that's the easiest first. And then
it
like,
can be so overwhelming. And also being productive in this environment is weird. At times it feels like a round hole square peg kind of thing where it's just like, you know what I mean? Like you're working against it. So sometimes I feel like part of it has been from the beginning for me is that idea of, as you said, being kind to yourself, that sometimes we're not as productive right now. Like sometimes it's literally impossible to be productive, or you're just, you can't pull it off. And then to give yourself that freedom to say it's okay. It's hard because you've been hustling your whole life.
Yes.
You've been hustling your whole life.
In the last few months, I had just bags of covered bridge potato chips for supper. Many.
They're so good.
Like when, if there's no kids around, like when Elsie's at her dad's or like Rose's at work, like I'm like, I don't have to make supper.
I'm trying to get a Covered Bridge sponsorship. I want a Covered Bridge chip sponsorship. I'm dead serious. I love
Well, one of the things I've noticed, though, is like if I eat a whole big bag of any type of chips for supper, I do wake up with really sore hands. I think the sodium is not, like, I think I'm having like a sodium thing.
Oh, I
like,
thought you meant literally from like the actual action of eating the chip. Just.
I've also taken a lot of baths during the pandemic. But also, one of the things I didn't even mention is like I work part time as a lifeguard at the pool in Dieppe.
Cool.
And right now we're in lockdown, so the pool's closed till January 30th, which is kind of nice because then I'm really just, my goal is to just try and focus on actually like writing some more songs in the next week. And then my boyfriend lives in Montreal most of the time, and he's coming tomorrow.
Oh, great.
He'll arrive tomorrow evening. He's bringing the studio, and our plan is to like record as much as we can next week.
Oh, good.
And so,
well, this is the thing. It's been a creative time. You know what I mean? It's because I think if we can, you know, if you're able to tap into that pace, it's just, then it can be a very creative time, but it takes time. And then there's these huge waves, as you said, of like existential dread. And you kind of have to, it's been, some of these conversations have been just about what you do in the, you know what I mean? Like, as you said, you've kind of, you're developing practices, you go walk in the woods, you do yoga, like there's, everybody's got different ways of kind of like some regular practices to keep good mental health.
Well, and there was like, I think that there was like some of the woods that I was walking, there was like one set of woods in particular that was making me cry without fail every day. And I was like, so at one point I started avoiding those ones because I just was tired of crying. But then I was like, maybe I have to go back to those woods because maybe there's a reason why maybe I needed to cry and let it out. And maybe those were the only woods that were like doing that for me. So I don't know. I feel like also like this time has been like where I've learned how to just like to come back to that idea of being kind to yourself, where I think it's a good, I've realized like to just like, you know, whatever you got to do to like feel good and feel safe and feel like, you know, there's times where, you know, well, before I had a dog, I would just stay home. Like, you know, days would go by and I wouldn't leave the house, you know, but then now, so I like having him because he does force me to go outside every day, which has been good. But so that's been helpful. But like, I feel like just giving yourself like, it's like, it's really hard to be human. Like I find, or maybe not everyone finds that hard, but I often do. And I think that we just have to like, I think one of the things that we're, and hopefully a lot of people are learning right now, is to just like be really kind to each other as well, and really just love each other. And this, I think a lot of the things that a lot of us have learned this year, like I think a lot of people had a hard time realizing that a lot of the people that they were close with, like went the opposite way from like in beliefs and stuff, like the whole like COVID stuff. Like, I think a lot of us were surprised, like, oh shit, that person believes that. And you know, there's that. So there was a lot of mourning too, like of like, I don't know,
relationships
like to go to. Yeah. And so that, and then realizing like, okay, I've just understanding like everyone's just trying to get by. And that's, you know, they ended up believing what they were fed, and we're, you know, I believe the things that, like, so it's like, I think as long as we're being really nice, like we have to be nice to each other and kind. And I think people need to stop being so hard on it. Like, I don't know why people have feelings.
It is a cruel world. And I fear the same thing. I think about the same things a lot. You know, if anything, this is, we were a relatively judgmental and cruel world before. And it seems like it in some ways, this has kind of driven a stake into things, and kind of, which I don't love, but I do hope that from a personal perspective, and I hope that it's changing. I do hope it's changing. Sometimes I like to, in my most optimistic and out there times, I kind of like to think that, you know, that this is going to force us to get to a more understanding place, because it's putting these pressures on us to understand each other and understand real disagreements. But we're still human beings, and we're still trying to get through this thing, and we're still struggling. And it doesn't matter what you believe, it's still hard. It sucks, right? Like, that's what I keep like, there's lots of different policies. You can argue about policy, you know, but at the end of the day, it's the virus is not great. Like, you know, it doesn't matter what you believe about how we should deal with it. It's still not a good, no one likes it. It's crap.
Yeah.
And so it's exposed us, and it, and lack of community and lack of touch and feel and relationship and all of that stuff, that is really, I think, is start, especially now, is starting to, it's starting to hurt our hearts. It's, you know, it sounds ridiculous, but it's not ridiculous. We're meant to be in community. And so it's, these are the, and we know we're doing the, I mean, you know, it's not that I disagree with what we're doing. It's that it's that this is where the strain comes. This is where it becomes difficult. You're like, oh, okay. First couple months. Sure.
Yeah.
But now we're like, oh, I really miss people. I miss people.
Yeah. It's an interesting time. And I really hope that, I think that I just get so, like, I think when I get really sucked out of my, when I get sucked into, like, the space where I'm like, oh, shit, like, I start to go down. It's when I realize, like, when I get scared for everybody, like, I just want everybody to have, I get so riled up when I think about how expensive rent is and how it's impossible. Like, I feel like people, every single human deserves, like, a safe place to live, and they deserve food. Like, they deserve a warm, safe place to live and sleep, and they deserve love and comfort and food, and they deserve respect. And I get so riled up, like, and then I feel bad because I have, like, my space, and I feel like, okay, well, what can I do to help? And then you get, like, and then you get all caught up, and then you're trying to do it on social media, and you're like, I don't know how to do this. Like, I didn't go to university. Like, I'm not that, like, I don't know how to even the first step. I'm, like, older. I don't, like, and then I get super down because I don't know how, like, you know what I mean? It's, like, this crazy cycle. And then all of a sudden, I'm like, well, how can I help? And then, like, next thing you know, you're, like, just, like, you don't know what to do. And you're, but I just wish, like, that people would understand that everyone needs to be loved, and they need feel safe, and I just,
and they deserve to be loved. They deserve people. Yeah. People deserve to be loved. This is what I think is to feel safe and to feel respected and all those things. And there is a distance. There's a distance there. There's like a, and that's what is hard to watch, especially if you're, especially on the social media element, because there's a distance. So people can say cruel things, and problems can feel insurmountable. Because we're seeing everything at the same time, you know. There isn't that human touch. There isn't that, you know, where you can feel like I you can give love to someone when you see them, and you can help people, and but when through the phone, sometimes it feels like that's it can seem very helpless sometimes.
Yeah, and I think that, like, if you have, like, I think that, for me, anyways, I tend to take on all, like, I take that all in, and it's just like, I can find that. So I find that, like, having contact with people and having, like, this has been really nice, because then you're like, okay, it's nice to be reminded that there's other humans, first of all, exist. It's like, but also just, like, it's good to, like, I don't know. I look forward to, I actually don't know. I actually know less now than I ever did, I think. And it's still, I feel wiser. I feel.
That's probably wisdom, though. It might be what wisdom looks like, is that it's a little bit of, it's like less knowing.
Yeah. I mean, I guess that's like a thing too, right? Like, we, you know, I don't know all the expressions, but I know that. Yeah.
You know, there is a bit of that, but I do. I know. I honestly, part of the reason why I think I started doing these conversations is because I wanted to connect with people about their emotional lives, especially people who are in the creative pursuit, because I don't want to feel alone.
Yeah.
I don't care if we play the same music or whatever, but I like this. I love these conversations because I think that, I don't know, I think they're fun for me, and I appreciate you doing this.
Yeah, and can I just add one more thing? Like, I don't know if, like, I was used to be really good at doing interviews. Like, I always felt like I you know, I learned when I was, like, in high school, like, when you're asked a question, you include the question into the answer. And I was, like, always really good at being like, oh, well, I started doing music when I was, you know, blah, blah, blah. And it's like, I always felt like I was, like, a model student in, like, interviewing. And then, when this record came out, this last record, my newest record, I was doing a lot of interviews and podcasts and things. I had never done so many podcasts. It was like my first, And almost every time I did one, I was like, oh, why did I sit? Like every time, I'm like, oh my God, Julie, you just dominated the conversation. You just spoke whenever like we want. Like I've forgotten how to like have conversations. And then I was realizing like, have I always just like cut people off nonstop? And maybe I did, and just now I'm aware of it because I spent so much time not talking to anyone. But like, and I got to the point where I was just like, I joke about this, but I talk to myself in the grocery store all the time. Like I have my mask and I'm like, oh, these look good. And like, oh, maybe I have any apples. And then like I'm just like counting, like I total up the money as I like total up as I'm going, okay, I'm up to $60 and like, okay, $3. So like, and then I'm just talking in the grocery store by myself. So thank you for being patient with me. Cause like,
you're the best. I've always liked chatting with you. In the number of times that we've run into each other, I've always enjoyed it. I knew I was going to enjoy this tonight. I really did. I was excited that you were keen to do it, and this is awesome. You're still great at it. Don't doubt. You still got it. You still got it.
I really like this. Like I would do these types of things. I guess maybe I should start a podcast. I don't know. I love talking to people. Like I've done a couple that were live, and I really enjoyed doing, like, you know, last year there was the sweetest little thing, which is like a fundraiser that Stretz Gallery and the Owens Art Gallery does here in Sackville. And it happens on Valentine's Day. And last year it was virtual. And it was really fun. And I think I played like two, I don't know, a song, or I don't remember, like a song, I think. And then I was watching like all the guests on the thing, and you could see, like, it was just really nice to be, to know that everybody was watching at the same time. And so even though we weren't in the same room in the traditional way, it was really nice to feel, I still felt connected. Like,
yeah. Yeah. No. And that's what's happening here. I mean,
well,
people,
the Happy Fest thing too was all like people, that ongoing 24-hour broadcast. So like,
that was really cool. Really well done.
Still felt connected. Like, yeah. You could still, cause you were still watching something live.
Yeah.
At the same time as you knew other people were, and people can comment. So we found a way to like get through it and still have connection, even though like we're not in the room together.
No. And we found ways quickly. You know what I mean? Like really, it shows how much humanity needs it. Cause we just like immediately look what grew the quickest: Zoom. You know what I mean? Like Zoom. We didn't know what Zoom was 2 years ago. It's cause we need to connect, you know, and it is real. It is real. Yeah. There are real, you know, it's so, you do what you can. And so I love the fact that festivals are finding ways to do things interestingly. I can't wait till we're all in the same room, and when we're all just hanging out and listening to live music and drinking beer together and everything else. It's going to be awesome.
I can't imagine dancing in public.
I've been practicing all year. I'm totally ready. I can't wait.
Okay, maybe I'm going to work on my moves a bit more. I know that, like, because when you think about, like, when you go on tour and after the show, sometimes it would turn into, like, dance parties or whatever, like, depending where you were. And I just trying to imagine, like, doing that right now. I think I could. I mean, I don't know.
You will. It will happen again. It will happen again.
Yeah.
Oh, that's great.
Well, thanks, David.
Thank you, Julie. I really appreciate it. And congrats on the great record. I can't wait. I hope to see you in person real soon.
Well, yeah.
Since we're both in New Brunswick, we'll see each other hopefully in the spring sometime when it opens up a bit.
Yeah.
Right on.
Thank you.
Cool. Thanks.
Do I hang up? Do I just go for it?
Yeah, yeah. You can just hang up, and then that's actually, I can hang up right now.
Well, thank you, everyone.
Please.
Thanks.
See ya.
Okay, bye.
Thanks. Thank you. Bye. All right, everybody. That was great. Thanks. You know, we just kept on chatting, and it was really nice to connect with Julie. Isn't she? She's special. She's super cool, super honest, down to earth, and a great, great songwriter. Because those are the same qualities that make great songwriters. Is that sincerity, that believability, all of that is so cool and so great. So if you get a chance, go listen to Julie Doiron's record. Go see her live when she's out touring again. You won't be disappointed. Thank you so much to Shivering Songs for helping support this broadcast of Myles From Home. Really appreciate it. Good luck with the festival. Check out Shivering Songs, one of the best festivals in Canada. We're so lucky to have it here in New Brunswick. May there be many, many more years of Shivering Songs to come. Take care, everybody. Peace. Thanks for watching.